Hello everyone, welcome to a new lecture from the Mobile Chem Research Group. Today we are going to talk about quantum mechanics, molecular mechanics. In particular, we are going to focus on the different partition schemes which are available and also in a few pitfalls that we can find when we carry out quantum mechanics, molecular mechanics calculations. Here you can see a few references about QMM, but of course you can find many papers in the literature published in the last decades about quantum mechanics and molecular mechanics. These four are only a short selection of papers. Okay, so let's start explaining the most general, the most common QMM partition schemes. So the first thing we need to know when carrying out the QMM calculations is that we are assuming that the electronic action takes place in a small region of the system, in a localized region of the system. And this region will be described quantum mechanically. For example, here we have our full system, which is divided into two regions. The inner region represented in red, and the outer region represented in blue, which is the environment which is surrounding the relevant region of our system. In the original subtractive scheme, the total energy of the system represented by the letter E in equation 1 is equal to the energy of the inner region described quantum mechanically plus the energy of the full system, inner region plus outer region described with molecular mechanics with a force field. But if you look here, if we consider only the first two terms of the equation, we are taking into account twice the inner region. So we need to add this third term in order to subtract the energy of the inner region at molecular mechanics level. In this way, we take into account only once the energy of the inner region. In a more schematic way, equation 1 can be represented in the following way. So we have here the inner region represented by this red square described by quantum mechanics, plus the energy of the full system, so we have here the red part plus the blue part, described by molecular mechanics. And as I said, here we are considering twice the energy of the inner region, so we need to subtract the energy of the inner region at molecular mechanics level. In this scheme, in the original subtractive scheme, the interaction between both layers is taking into account in this calculation where we describe the full system with the force field. So we are taking into account the interaction between both layers at classical level. So let's see the main features of this scheme. As we already said, the interaction between the inner and the outer layers is computed by a force field. Something which is very important is that the QM region, so the inner region, is not polarized by the presence of the MM region. So in other words, the inner region doesn't feel the charge distribution of the outer region. This is a scheme which is easy to implement. Something which is also good is that there is no QMM interface, so we don't have border artifacts as we have in other schemes we are going to see later. And also, the original subtractive scheme can be generalized to multiple layers very easily, for example, like in the onion approximation. Let's see an example where we can generalize the previous equation for a three-layer situation. Let's assume we have layer number one, which will be described at high level of theory. We have a second layer, L2, which will be described at medium level of theory. And finally, we have a third layer represented in green here, which will be described at low level of theory. So we can write the energy of the full system in the following way. So the energy will be the energy of the full system computed with the low level of theory. So here we have the three layers computed, for example, with a force field, which is usually the low level of theory. Now we have the energy of the medium level system, sorry, the energy of the layer 2 and the layer 1 computed with the medium level approximation. And finally, we have the energy of the layer 1, only the red part of the system, the inner layer, computed with a high level of theory. If we focus our attention in these three terms, we can see here that the layer 1, which is the red region here, is considered three times. This means we need to subtract two times the energy of the layer 1. And also, we have here two times the energy of the layer 2. So we need to subtract once the energy of this layer. In order to do that, we need to add here this term. So we can compute the energy of the layers 1 and 2 using the low level of theory. And also we can subtract the energy of the layer 1 computed with the medium level of theory. So in this way, if you count the number of times each layer appears, you will see that we have only once each of the layers. And in the when we consider the full equation, the layer number 1 is computed with the highest level of theory. The layer number 2, so the blue one, is computed with the medium level of theory. And the layer 3 is computed with the low level of theory, usually a force field. This equation also can be written for 4, 5, 6, or for n layers. So what we have seen until now is the original subtractive scheme, where the interaction between the inner layer and the outer layer is computed with molecular mechanics. More recent subtractive schemes have been developed where the interaction between layers is computed quantum mechanically using an effective Hamiltonian. And in this way, the inner region is polarized by the presence of the charge distribution of the outer region. So let's see this in a more schematic way. So we have again the inner region represented in red, the outer region represented in blue, and the energy of the full system is computed by equation 3 again. So the equation 3 says that the energy of the full system is equal to the energy of the inner region computed quantum mechanically, plus the energy of the full system computed with molecular mechanics. And as we have seen, we are taking into account twice the energy of the inner region, so we need to subtract the energy of the inner region at classical level. The difference between this equation and the previous equation we have seen in previous slides is now this superscript here, QO. This subscript here means, in this term and also in this one, that when we compute the energy of the inner region at quantum mechanical level and at classical level, we are taking into account the charge distribution of the outer region. So, in a more schematic way, we have the energy of the inner region computed with quantum mechanics, plus the energy of the full system computed with the force field, minus the energy of the inner region computed with the force field. So until now, this is exactly the same as the original subtractive scheme. Now, we are adding here the charges of the outer region in the first and in the third term of equation 3. So in a schematic way, we represent this in this way. So we have here the inner region computed quantum mechanically, but now we also consider the charge distribution of the outer region. So we consider the interaction between the inner region and the classical charges of the outer region. And the same here. Okay, so how do we consider the charge distribution of the outer region interacting with the inner region? So we define an effective Hamiltonian, and this Hamiltonian is equal to the Hamiltonian of the inner region in vacuum plus an interacting Hamiltonian. And this interacting Hamiltonian is equal to an electrostatic Hamiltonian, where we are describing the interaction between the electrostatic potential created by the inner region, which is represented here by the letter V, and the charges of the outer region. So, if we take into account this interacting Hamiltonian, when we solve the Schrödinger equation 4, the wave function of the inner region we obtain is the wave function which is polarized by the presence of the classical charges. So we are taking into account the interaction between the inner region and the outer region, at least the electrostatic part, in a quantum mechanical manner. Now, we need to add here also the charge distribution of the outer region in this calculation, because if we don't consider the charge distribution here, we are computed two times, here and here, the interaction between the inner region and the outer region. For example, in the first term, we are computed the interaction between the inner region and the outer region quantum mechanically, with this effective Hamiltonian and with the Schrödinger equation. And here, we are also computed the interaction between the inner region and the outer region in a classical manner. So we need to subtract here the interaction between the inner region and the charge distribution of the outer region at a classical level of theory. So let's move to the next scheme, which is the additive scheme. So in this occasion, the interaction between the inner region and the outer region is computed in a separate way. So we will have a special term to describe this interaction. So we have again here the inner region represented in red and the outer region represented in blue. And now this is the equation which the additive scheme uses. So the total energy is equal to the energy of the inner region computed quantum mechanically, the energy of the outer region computed with molecular mechanics, plus the interaction between both regions computed in a special way. So this term here can be written as follows. Usually, we will have bonded interactions between the inner and the outer region, and these interactions are described with molecular mechanics. We are going to have also van der Waals interactions between the inner region and the outer region, which usually are also described with molecular mechanics, for example, with a Lennard-Jones potential. And here we also have electrostatic interactions between both layers. And this is the key term, the relevant term in equation set. So as I said, this term is usually computed classically, in particular, if one of the atoms belongs to the outer region, then this interaction is computed classically. For example, let's assume we have this molecule, we want to describe this molecule, and for whatever reason, we do the following partition. So our inner region is just this acid group, and the rest of the molecule is the outer region. Of course, this is a very bad partition, but this is just an example to understand this term here. So for example, if we want to compute the torsion interaction between this atom and this atom, so this is the typical dihedral term in a force field. So since we have one of the atoms belonging to the outer region, so this torsion interaction is computed classically with the force field. And for example, if we want to describe the van der Waals interaction between this hydrogen atom here and this hydrogen atom here, as one of the atoms belongs to the outer region, this interaction is also computed classically. And as I said, the electrostatic term here is the important term of equation 7, and we have different ways to take into account the electrostatic interaction between the inner and the outer layers. So the first scheme is called mechanical embedding, and in the mechanical embedding, the electrostatic interaction is computed classically with a force field. That means that the inner region is not polarized by the outer region. So this is a similar situation as in the original subtractive scheme, where the interaction between both layers was also computed classically. So usually we use the Coulomb equation to compute the interaction between the charges in the inner region and the charges in the outer region. The most common approximation used nowadays is the electrostatic embedding approximation, where the electrostatic interaction is computed by using an effective Hamiltonian that includes the charge distribution of the outer region. So this is a very similar situation as the most recent subtractive scheme we have seen in the previous slides. So we have the inner region and the outer region. We have the charge distribution of the outer region, the classical charges, and we can define again an effective Hamiltonian, which is equal to the Hamiltonian of the inner region in vacuum plus an interacting Hamiltonian. And as we have seen before, this interacting Hamiltonian describes the interaction between the electrostatic potential created by the inner region and the classical charges. So in this way, the wave function that we obtain here is a wave function which is polarized by the presence of the classical charges. A more accurate approximation is the polarizable embedding. In the polarizable embedding, there is a mutual polarization between the inner region and the outer region, and this polarization is computed in a self-consistent manner. So, we have again our inner region here, we have again the outer region with the classical charges, and we have our effective Hamiltonian, which includes again this interacting term, which describes the interaction between the inner and the outer layers. But in this equation, we will have an additional term. We have the electrostatic interaction between both layers, which is described in the same manner as we have seen before. So this is the interaction between the classical charges of the outer region and the electrostatic potential created by the inner region. But now we have here a polarization term. And this polarization term describes the interaction between the dipole moments of the outer region here and the electric field created by the inner region at the position of the classical charges. So the classical dipoles of the outer region will react to the changes in the electric field of the QN region. So now we have the polarization of the inner region because of the presence of the outer region, but also we have the polarization of the outer region because of the presence of the inner region. So we have a mutual polarization. The polarization of the classical region can be taken into account in different ways, for example, using induced dipoles, fluctuating charges, or Drude oscillators. But here, we are going to see only one of these three approximations, which is the induced dipole approximation. And in any of these three approximations, where we take into account the polarization of the environment, the polarization of the outer region, we need to use a polarizable force field to describe the outer layer. In a future lecture, we are going to talk about polarizable force fields in more detail. Okay, so let's have a look at the induced dipole approximation. So we have again our inner region in red, the outer region in blue, and in the outer region we are going to have now point charges Q and also dipole moments in each of the atomic positions A. The inner region will generate an electric field which will interact with the dipole moments of the outer region, and also an electrostatic potential which will interact with the point charges of the outer region. Here we have again the interacting Hamiltonian between both layers, where, as we have seen, we have the electrostatic interaction between the classical charges and the quantum mechanical potential, and now we have also the polarization interaction, which describes the interaction between the dipole moments of the classical region and the electric field generated by the quantum mechanical region. So in this equation, we need to compute the dipole moments on the classical positions A. And these dipole moments can be computed as the polarizability of the center A multiplied by the electric field. So usually this polarizability is just a parameter of the force field. Here, the electric field, this is the total electric field, which is the sum of the electric field due to the presence of the inner region plus the electric field generated by the classical region. But this electric field of the classical region depends on the dipole moments of the classical region. But indeed, we are computed the dipole moments of the classical region. So that means that these two equations has to be solved in a self-consistent manner. Okay, if we come back now to the original equation of the energy, remember that the energy of the full system is just the energy of the quantum mechanical region, the energy of the classical region, and the interaction between both layers. This interaction, as we have seen, is computed using this effective Hamiltonian, which includes electrostatic interactions and also polarization interactions. Now, if we focus on this term, here we need to compute the energy of the outer region at molecular mechanics level. And this is now different from the previous scheme because we are using a polarizable force field. So we are going to have the bond interactions, van der Waals interactions, and electrostatic interactions between the point charges. These are the three terms which also appear in a standard force field. But now we have also the polarization interactions between the classical atoms in our outer region. And in order to describe these two terms, so the electrostatic interaction is described as usual by the Coulomb equation, but the polarization interaction is described by this term. So here we have the interaction between the dipole moments of the classical region and the electric field generated by the charges of the classical region. So as we said before, we need a polarizable force field in order to describe the polarization energy of the outer region. Okay, so after seeing the most common QMM schemes, now we are going to see shortly a couple of pitfalls which are related with the use of QMM approximations. So the first one is called electron spillout or overpolarization. And in order to understand this concept of overpolarization, we are going to use the density functional theory framework in order to write down the energy of the system. So in DFT, the energy can be written as the kinetic energy of the electrons plus the interaction between the electronic density and the external potential, which is the potential created by the nuclei, plus the electron-electron interaction. So here we have the interaction between the electronic density of electronic density in a particular region and electronic density in a different region of our system. We also have the exchange correlation energy, and finally we have the repulsion between nuclei. As you know, the exchange correlation energy accounts for the non-classical interaction between electrons, but also accounts for the difference between the exact kinetic energy and the kinetic energy of a system formed by non-interacting electrons. Okay, so let's assume we have our system formed by two regions, A and B. And we want to divide the system just to compare our DFT equation with the QMM equation, where we also have two regions in our system. So in this system, the electronic density of the full system can be written as the sum of the electronic density of each of the fragments. And the energy is the sum of the energy of the fragments A and B, and also the interaction energy between fragments. In equation 16, the kinetic energy of the electrons and also the exchange correlation energy are non-linear terms. This means that the kinetic energy of the system cannot be written just as the sum of the kinetic energy of both fragments. So we will have also here a non-linear term, which accounts for the interaction between these fragments A and B. So in other words, The kinetic energy of the system A will be affected by the presence of the system B, and also the other way around. So we have here a non-linear term. We have also the same situation in the exchange correlation potential. The total exchange correlation potential is the sum of the exchange correlation potential of fragments A and B plus a non-linear term here. So these non-linear terms, as I said, are more important in the regions where the system A and B overlap, because in these regions the interaction between both fragments are more relevant, and this will induce a higher importance of the nonlinear terms in equations 19 and 20. Okay, so let's rewrite equation 16, which is the equation of the energy. So the total energy of the system can be written as the kinetic energy of the system of the fragment A, kinetic energy of the fragment B, plus the nonlinear term. So the first three terms represent the total kinetic energy of the system, the electronic kinetic energy. Now we also have the three contributions from the exchange correlation part. So we have exchange correlation from the fragment A, from the fragment B, and the nonlinear term. And now we have the linear terms to the energy, which contributes linearly to the energy. So we have the interaction between the electronic density of fragment A and the nuclei of fragment A, electronic density of fragment B and nuclei of fragment B, and now we have electronic density of B interacting with the nuclei from A, and electronic density from A interacting with the nuclei from B. So these four terms represent the electron nucleus interaction of our system. We have a similar term for the electron-electron interaction. So here we have the interaction between electrons within system A, interaction between electrons within system B, and interaction of electrons of system B with electrons of system A. And finally, we have also the interacting terms for the nuclei. So here we have interaction between nuclei belonging to the fragment A, nuclei within the fragment B, and now nuclei of fragments A and B. Okay, let's reorganize a bit this equation. So if we write the equation of the energy in this simple manner, so we have the energy of the fragment A plus the energy of the fragment B plus the interaction energy. So if we look at this large equation, we can identify these three different terms. So for example, the energy of the fragment A is the kinetic energy of fragment A, the exchange correlation contribution, the interaction between the electronic density of A with the nuclei of A, now the interaction between electrons within fragment A, and interaction between nuclei within fragment A. We can also identify the analogous terms for the fragment B. And finally, the other terms represent the interaction between the fragments A and B. So if we write the equation which represents the interaction between A and B, we have all these terms. And just for simplicity, we are going to represent all these interactions, which are the interactions between electrons and nuclei in our system, in this simplified manner with this term here. So this term represents the interaction between electrons and nuclei between A and B. So we arrive to this equation, which accounts for the interaction between fragments. So here we have the non-linear contributions to the electronic kinetic energy and to the exchange correlation potential, and also we have the interactions between the electronic and the nuclear densities of our system. Now we are going to try to relate equation 23 with the QMMN equations. So here we have a similar partition of our system, but instead of A and B, now we have the inner region and the outer region. So the interaction between both regions can be written as the van der Waals interaction, which usually is computed at classical level, as we have seen, plus the electrostatic interaction between both layers. And this electrostatic part, if you remember, is the relevant one, and is the one which can be described at different levels of theory, giving rise to different QMN schemes. Okay, so this term in equation 23, which remember describes the interaction between electrons and nuclei, is usually approximated in QMN calculations by this electrostatic interaction. And if you remember, in the most commonly employed electrostatic embedding scheme, this interaction, the electrostatic interaction between the inner region and the outer region, is computed as the interaction between the electrostatic potential generated by the inner region and the classical charges. And usually this is a good approximation. So usually equation 25 describes well this term in equation 23. So the electrostatic interactions between electrons and nuclei. The problem is found when we try to describe the nonlinear contribution to the exchange correlation potential, because usually this nonlinear contribution is described with the classical van der Waals interaction. Usually for this classical van der Waals interaction, we use a Lennard-Jones potential. In this Lennard-Jones potential, we have a positive term which tries to account for the Pauli repulsion, and also we have this negative term which tries to account for the attractive interactions between the inner and the outer region, for example, dispersion interactions. And the problem is that this term is not enough to describe accurately the Pauli repulsion between the inner region and the outer region. So we will see that because of this bad description of the Pauli repulsion, we will have an unphysical behavior of the electronic density of the inner region. It is also important to say that the nonlinear contribution to the electronic kinetic energy is not taken into account in this kind of QMN calculations. Okay, so as we said, we have a bad description of the Pauli repulsion between both regions, so that means that sometimes we can have an unrealistic attraction between the electronic density of the inner region and the positive charges of the classical region. This is represented in the following scheme. For example, we have here in the outer region a few positive point charges close to this QMN border. And these positive charges will interact in an unrealistic manner with the electronic density of the inner region. So this electronic density, for example, can be deformed in this way, and we will have here an unrealistic attraction between the positive point charges of the outer region and this deformed electronic density. And this unrealistic attraction is a consequence of the bad description of the Pauli repulsion between both regions. And this is more important for the atoms which are close to the QMN border, and also it is very important when we use diffuse basis sets to describe the QMN region, because when we have large basis sets, the electronic density will delocalize over a large region in the space. These unrealistic interactions, so this overpolarization, can be somehow prevented by screening the electrostatic interactions between both layers. For example, some approximations use this error function here in order to screen the interaction between the classical charges and the quantum mechanical electronic density. So with this error function, when the electronic density is close to the positive charges of the classical region, so the interaction vanishes. Another pitfall that we can find when we carry out QMN calculations occurs when we have a covalent bond between the QN region and the MN region, as in this situation. So here we have a covalent bond between the quantum mechanical atom number one and the molecular mechanics atom number one. So here we have a covalent bond, and When we perform the quantum mechanical calculation for the inner region, as you know, we cut the system here, and when we cut the system, now the QM1 atom is unsaturated. So in other words, we have here a kind of radical, and because of this, the electronic situation of our quantum mechanical system is very different from the electronic situation of the real system, because in the real molecule, we don't have here an unpaired electron, right? So there are different ways to solve this situation. The most common one is to use the link atom approximation. Usually, the link atom is a hydrogen atom, so we cap the balance of the QM1 atom with a hydrogen atom, and now, when we perform the QM calculation, this hydrogen atom is included in the calculation, so now we don't have any more a radical here. Of course, this is not an ideal situation because we don't have a hydrogen atom here in reality, but it is better than having a radical and unpaired electron in the atom QM1. So when we add here this link atom, we have an additional problem, which is the following. So the charge of the MM1 atom now is very close to this hydrogen atom. So that means this interaction will be unrealistically high. So in order to avoid this unrealistic attraction or repulsion, depending on the sign of the QMM1 charge, we can do the following. Usually, we can set this charge to zero, and then we redistribute the charge among the neighboring atoms. So there are several schemes in order to solve this situation that we are going to see in a future lecture. Also, there exist other approximations different from the link atom approach. For example, we can also use localized orbitals in order to cap the unsaturated balance of the atom QM1 here. But as I said, we are going to see these more sophisticated schemes in a future lecture. So that's it. Thank you very much for watching and see you in the next lecture.